Lord Christopher Monckton will be joining us in the second hour to give us a detailed breakdown on the EU contagion that is threatening the world economy. And this is a EU problem, not a Grecian problem. Very important information. There is a massive disinformation campaign that is now heating back up concerning Jade Helm that is going to kick off here in just a few days. Jade Helm 15 and the media, from the Washington Post to television, is implying and saying that we're saying this is an imminent martial law takeover and editing clips of us together to make it sound like that's what we've said. What we've said is there is a large slow motion federalization, globalization takeover of society. So we're going to be looking at that. Here's the Washington Post going with the same headline the Austin American Statesman used. The Americans are coming. Some in a Texas county fear an Obama-led U.S. military invasion. And the Washington Post is going on to say that it's racist. There's another article breaking this down because Obama's black. That's why people don't like Jade Helm. No, we see the military in Stars and Stripes and in Army Times admitting that they're training to take on the Tea Party and gun owners during a civil war in this country. And we have all the Army documents admitting preparations for civil unrest and for rounding people up. That's why folks are concerned with the government lying and the government being illegitimate, the government being rogue, and just the president operating as a dictator on so many fronts. That's why Texas wants his $1 billion of gold back from the private Federal Reserve. That's why Texas has had to put thousands of state police on the border, because the feds just erased it. Our government's openly funding Al-Qaeda and ISIS. And Obama has now come out. We have video of this. It's coming up in the next segment. And he says, we will not defeat ISIS with guns, but with better ideas. Really? So you're going to go talk to them, and then they're just going to stop what they're doing? No, you, Mr. President, represent the cartel that basically laid the ISIS egg and then sat on it. And then now you've been busy, the mama bird, vomiting weapons and taxpayer money into their mouths. Obama is the father of ISIS. The United States, as a contingent of NATO, has been on record the number one funder of the Free Syrian Army, with John McCain over there hanging out with the ISIS leaders back when they were under different names of al-Nusra and the rest of it. It's all Wahhabist. But the average American doesn't know what the 4th of July is, doesn't know why we celebrate it. There's a new poll out, national poll, 19% know what the First Amendment is. So, of course, they can fund the terrorist publicly and get away with it, because I've seen TV newscast where Australian TV goes out in the U.S. and holds up a sign of Australia and says, there's Al-Qaeda stand, should we nuke it? And they're like, yes, let's attack. They go to the next 10 people and they all want to blow up Australia. The public basically are lobotomized gerbils. And that's why we're in so much trouble. Our government runs the terrorist organizations, the narcotics, the snuff films, and everything evil. We'll be back. It's already 7-7. Tuesday, the 7th day of July, 2015. It's hard to believe it's the 10th anniversary since the London false flag bombings. I traveled a few days after the bombings to London, England, and of course made the film Terror Storm, a history of government-sponsored terrorism. And in that case, they had a drill with the Metropolitan Police and Scotland Yard of the exact same trains and bus being bombed at the exact same time and exact same location. Peter Powers, the former head of public relations at Scotland Yard, was running the drill and admitted on BBC and ITN that day that they were running a drill of the exact same thing and that he thought it was fantastical. I'm not saying they were involved in the attack. They were hired to create a smokescreen with the drill in case any operatives got caught. But it is impossible. And even mainstream news had to admit it was basically one out of, what, 23 tetragillion insurance actuary was done that could have happened. In fact, we should probably try to get Paul Watson. I didn't think of this. We should probably try to get Paul Watson, who covered it on for maybe the last 20 minutes of the show, Lord of the second hour, because Lord Monckton is coming on to break down the whole EU contagion, the meltdown, the Greece situation, and where all of that is going. Could this be the death of the EU that we're beginning to see? Paul Watson would be perfect to be on the last 20 minutes of that hour to go over and to repost some of the articles that he and I wrote that were the top stories at the time concerning 7/7. I mean, they got millions of readers. And we would just post the video of them admitting that the exact same trains and bus at the exact same time and exact same location in the drill is where the terrorists struck. The so-called terrorists were set up. They thought they were part of another drill. And it turned out MI6 was managing them through a character named Aswat, who was the leader of Al-Qaeda in England, and who was allowed to then travel in and out of the country unmolested. Even Fox News had to report that indeed he was MI6. And John Loftus, former top-level anti-terrorism head at the Justice Department, came on this show and talked about it. And I'm only scratching the surface there. We've got all this other news. It's just important to remember that a lot of this terror gets staged. 7/7 was completely staged. Now, shifting gears out of that, there's three different types of staged terror. Purely staged, provocateur patsy staged, and wind-up toy. And ISIS is the mother of wind-up toys. You don't control a wind-up toy. You wind it up, you turn it loose, and it goes around in circles running into things. A wind-up toy is Black Widows. Take 100 Black Widows, you know my allegory, dump it in your neighbor's bed because you don't like them, and you didn't physically bite your neighbor or kill them, but the Black Widows will give it their best shot. That's a wind-up toy. But two or three rattlesnakes in somebody's bed, or cobras, that's a wind-up toy. 7/7 was not a wind-up toy. It was staged. ISIS is a wind-up toy, multi-hundred-thousand-man operation, allowed to recruit on Facebook and Twitter, allowed to recruit and fly in and out of the United States, Canada, England, Germany, and all over Europe, France. And now they've got cells and copycat cells, fellow travelers, lone wolf fellow travelers, that are in all 48 contiguous states. They are in every European country. And whenever, I guess, ISIS feels like it, whenever the time is right, signals will be sent through Western handlers to the double and triple agent commanders who will then activate the operations. And that's why when they came out 3 weeks ago and said, start attacking Western targets, I said, it's going to be real. You're going to see attacks. They'll be badly coordinated, low intensity, because they're not staged. They happened. I'm an expert on this, folks. I spend hours every few days studying it, talking to all the top experts. The ISIS situation is a real threat, and I'm not even talking about the few dozen or a few hundred people they're going to kill. I'm sad for those folks that get killed. We're trying to stop it. But the big issue is how they're going to use it to take our liberties. The government and the government-controlled media thinks you're so stupid and I'm so stupid that they're going to basically let Al-Qaeda slash ISIS attack us, and then no one is going to point out, I guess, hey, our government funded them, our government created them. Rand Paul, and we should play some of these clips, I'm giving the guy short notice, but try to find Rand Paul and Ted Cruz saying we shouldn't be Al-Qaeda's Air Force. Hillary said we helped create them. I mean, it's all true, but that's her covering her butt. When she admits it, when she's heavily involved in Benghazi and the head of the State Department, when they launched this program 5 years ago to arm these groups and turn them loose on Syria, Egypt, Iraq, Libya, she now wants to cover her butt and say, oh, it's terrible. We made a mistake. Al-Qaeda's back worse than ever, now called ISIS. When she is right in the middle of doing it. So now they know the attacks are coming, so they start demonizing the guy that exposed them at the greatest level. And that's Rand Paul. And they're saying when the attack comes, Chris Christie and others, it's Rand Paul's fault. Because Rand Paul is the only one other than Ted Cruz, but Rand Paul keeps doing it. Rand Paul keeps beating the drum. Ted Cruz has shut up and clearly gotten word to shut his mouth. Rand Paul is traveling the whole U.S. giving speeches, going on radio and TV, and pointing out that we created the Free Syrian Army, that John McCain went over there and helped set them up with Hillary's support, and that they're going to hit us. And so now they are politically assassinating him, trying to, and saying when terror attacks come, it's his fault for 4 years ago trying to stop the funding of these people. He actually is a hero, so in inverted reality, it's his fault. And in this upside-down planet, we now have Obama coming out saying that ISIS will not be defeated with guns, but with better ideas. When Obama and the EU run offense and defense for the radical Islamists, bringing them into Europe, bringing them into the United States, protecting them, giving the Free Syrian Army over $7 million the last 4.5 years that we know of, Hillary at the State Department allowing the weapons to be transferred, it goes on and on and on. And then airlifts giving them weapons. I've had Tosh Plumlee, current CIA pilot, on. Look him up. He's in the congressional record. You go, how does he still have a job at the CIA when he blew the whistle on government drug dealing in the 70s and the 80s and is one of the biggest Iran-Contra witnesses? Because the whole government's not bad. There's a white side and a dark side. And Plumlee has won all his court cases, and so they can't uninstate him as a contract pilot. Yeah, the Justice Department has threatened him. Yeah, they started following me around once I had him on. He's coming on soon. I mean, they're really mad at us. But do they really want to arrest us for exposing that we have NATO sources? He does. I don't want to have them. It's too dangerous. And Pentagon sources that have been there. When the C-130s deliver high-impact kinetic weapons, missiles, equivalent of tow missiles, you name it, anti-tank and anti-helicopter and anti-aircraft missiles, directly to guys with Al-Qaeda flags. And our special forces flipped out starting 4 years ago when these guys would laugh at them and say, we're going to kill you next, as they were delivering them chest of missiles. And let me tell you, they're going to start shooting down Western aircraft. The media will never point out our government gave it to them. And the word is they went on the market and bought Russian and Chinese armor-piercing knockoff tow missiles. I forget the name. I think it's Red Arrow. Yeah, look up Red Arrow. Check my facts, my memory. And also Chinese and Russian anti-aircraft handheld missiles. So there's going to be a whole setup there, too. And I'm just giving you, this has got the CIA, the NSA, the Pentagon with red smoke coming out of their ears. I have a responsibility to tell you the truth, no matter how dangerous it is. You understand, this radio show is not a game. Okay, now let's go ahead and let's go to this clip of Obama that we just need to have better ideas. What, Caitlyn Jenner? Maybe tell Al-Qaeda how to wear a dress? Will that idea trump them? Or how about some Obamacare? How about some 2 + 2 = 5? Maybe that idea will defeat them against Western weapons. Most of them, Colt M16s, U.S. 308 rifles, 5.56. Most of it's U.S.-made delivery. Oh, they accidentally got special forces trucks and armored trucks. No, they didn't. They were given them. They were armed in Iraq. They were armed in other areas like Turkey. Let's go ahead and go to the clip.
And that means that we're going to have to pick up our game
to
prevent these attacks. Uh-huh. It's also true why, ultimately, in order for us to defeat terrorist groups like ISIL and Al-Qaeda, is going to also require us to discredit their ideology.
Oh, yeah, sure.
The twisted thinking that draws vulnerable people into their ranks.
Oh, you're so evil.
As I've said before, and I know our military leaders agree, this broader challenge of countering violent extremism is not simply a military effort.
Oh, yeah.
Ideologies are not defeated with guns. They're defeated by better ideas. More attractive and more compelling.
We're going to break. We'll come back and play the full clip. No, here it is translated. This is our proxy army funded by NATO to take over the Middle East and kill all the Christians. And we're going to keep giving them weapons to do it. And then we're going to use them to take your rights domestically. So we need the NSA to spy on you every minute while the border's wide open. And we need to train the military to operate domestically. That's to take on the Tea Party. For an imminent civil war, they say, is coming out of the blue sky. And our president says we can't fight ISIL, the Islamic State, with guns. We have to fight it with ideas. When our so-called allies of Turkey and Saudi Arabia and Qatar are publicly funding these proxy armies to take out all of their enemies and run around chopping off every Christian head they find and blowing up every non-radical mosque and every Shiite mosque they find. This is a Wahhabist, Sunni, Islamic takeover of the Middle East. And hey, if the Muslims, the Shiites, and the Sunnis want to kill each other, I don't have a dog in that fight. But my government shouldn't be arming the Sunnis to go do it, especially when the Shiite non-radicals in areas of the Middle East, like Syria, let women go to college. They're not attacking the United States. They're not sexually mutilating women. They're not chopping Christians' heads off. They're not stoning Jews to death. Where are the feminists? Where are the liberals? Because they're not feminists or liberals. It's all just a thing to beat people over the head politically here to accept turning our guns in and Obama screw job care and open borders and globalism. When the rubber meets the road, our government, as a litmus test, is arming Islamic State, the new Free Syrian Army, to range around and create failed states all over the Middle East. Egypt, the government, defeated the West's attempted total takeover. But for the year that the Western allies, the Muslim Brotherhood, the Sunnis, were in control, there was a rain of murder and terror and rioting and throwing gays off buildings and chopping Christians' heads off and crucifying them upside down. Just anybody who wasn't a Sunni. And by the way, Syrian girl that comes on is Sunni, and she's against this. Most Sunnis aren't like this. I mean, I have studied the demographics. Sunnis are 79% of Islam, and the vast majority of them are not bloodthirsty psychopathic killers. They're killing non-radical Sunnis because Saudi Arabia is the homeland of radical Islam and it's allied with our criminal rogue government. It ran the attacks of 9/11, working with criminals in our government to take American freedom and attack their archenemy at the time, Iraq, who was blamed when Saddam gave speeches saying, I'm archenemies with Al-Qaeda. They're always trying to kill me. They work for Saudi Arabia. I've been set up. I worked with your government. I was trained in Egypt by the CIA. I was told to attack Iran. I have been set up. Saddam gave all those speeches. They were true. Does it mean Saddam was an angel cake? Does it mean Hosni Mubarak was an angel? No, but they were Western dictators who did not persecute at 1/100th that Al-Qaeda does. But they had made-for-TV movies and HBO movies and all about how bad Saddam was. Saddam could go stand in a crowd of 20,000 people with AK-47s and no one was shooting. Under Saddam Hussein, they had total Second Amendment rights. Now, Iraq's being broken in three parts. And our president has the nerve to come out and say we need to beat Al-Qaeda, because that's what ISIS is and ISIL. with ideas when he knows full well they're funding them and it's a proxy army. The whole Pentagon knows, the whole military knows. And the good news is they've spoken out against it. You've seen hearings, but they've successfully contained all that now and shut down a debate about it. We have to force that debate back out in the open. They just changed the name to confuse the public. Here is the traitor in chief.
And that means that we're going to have to pick up our game to prevent these attacks.
Means take your freedom.
It's also true why ultimately, in order for us to defeat terrorist groups like ISIL and Al-Qaeda, is going to also require us to discredit their ideology, the twisted thinking that draws vulnerable people into their ranks. As I've said before, and I know our military leaders agree, this broader challenge of countering violent extremism is not simply a military effort. Ideologies are not defeated with guns, they're defeated by better ideas.
Horse crap.
More attractive and more compelling vision. So the United States will continue to do our part by working with partners to counter ISIL's hateful propaganda, especially online. We'll constantly reaffirm through words and deeds
They're going to restrict everybody's free speech and pass cybersecurity laws on the back of this and take freedoms domestically to fight the proxy armies they've released. We're going to come back and get into all the other news on Greece, the knockout game, the economy, and so much more. I want to just read the different stacks of headlines before I launch into the next areas, sections of news. This is so important that I'm going to spend a large portion of the third hour on it because, again, it illustrates the inversion of reality, not just the story itself. There are 700 plus million people south of the U.S. border. If you've ever been to Central or South America, it's super beautiful, has a lot of interesting things. The people come off as very funny, very nice, very creative, very smart. But they never got out from under colonialism, and there are stabbings, shootings. I mean, it's as dangerous as Chicago all over Central and South America. It's wild, wild west. It's dangerous. And their prisons are hellish. And when people run from the law in Latin America, but now it's China, Russia, you name it, they come to the United States because you can get fake IDs and blend in and be left alone. If you're a citizen, though, and you do something wrong or you use a fake ID, you hear about them busting people that have been using a fake Social Security number for 20 years, not to steal an identity of somebody that's dead, not to steal money, but just to change your identity. Because you're a convicted criminal or something, you hear about people getting raided all the time. But if you're an illegal that's committed rapes, murders, arson, you name it, you come here and you're above the law. And then Trump talks about that and they are trying to crucify him. And again, whether you like Trump or don't like Trump, if they can crucify someone telling the truth, they crucify the truth. And now there's video of the arrogant San Francisco sheriff who released the seven-time felon. He'd been deported five times. He was about to be deported. ICE wanted him. And they just released this guy, and he went and shot a woman for no reason in front of witnesses. First denied he did it. Now says, oh, he just picked the gun up and it shot her by accident. And then he said, he was shooting sea lions. Then it was he didn't remember. Then it was an accident. And then he was just pointing it at her. And then now he wasn't pointing it at her. It was in a bag. And then next. I mean, this guy's a worse liar than Bill Clinton. And the issue is, I've been hit twice by illegals. Drunk. Once at a fast food restaurant. Drive through. It wasn't that bad, but they hit me on about 8 miles an hour and crunched in some stuff. Had no license, had no info. Cops said nothing I can do. Another time, same thing. Got back-ended going down I-35. Probably only going 20 miles an hour, stop and go traffic. I've back-ended somebody before. Difference is, I got the ticket. My insurance had to pay. Cops come. Guy just goes, no speak English. You're gone. Everybody you know has experienced this or knows somebody that has. The drunk driving, the hit and running, the raping, the stealing, the killing. Does that say that people in Latin America are inherently bad people? No. But Latin America has collapsed into a crime wave. There's 110,000 dead Mexicans in the last 8 years that we know of. When college kids protest the corrupt government, they go and kidnap 20-something of them and kill them. That's the government. There's a report out from MRC TV. Border report backs up Trump's rapist claim. Well, of course it does. And that ties in, I'll cover it in the third hour in great detail, the knockout game. I've seen four different knockout games since Sunday. Two of them I sent to you guys. The other two I need to dig up and give you. New videos from Rockstar Hip Hop and all the other sites that celebrate this stuff, where you got an old white guy or an old white woman. A lot of times it's even a homeless person. And a black teenager walks over and punches him in the head. And sometimes they fall over and hit their head and die. And it's clearly racial. The sites say it's racial. Hey, look at that old cracker ass hit the ground. You know, great job. And when the Klan does something like that, that's the exact kind of stuff the Klan used to pull and still does sometimes, is you go find some old homeless black guy and you kill him. Same MO. I can pull up the stories. But see, when they do it, it's a big deal. But when black people do it, it's not a big deal. Just like when Hispanics go around committing crimes, mainly against Hispanics, doesn't tend to be racial, except against blacks. Hispanics commit, on average, at the crime statistics in Austin and in L.A. and in Dallas and in Houston and in San Francisco against blacks. They have a derogatory term for them. The point is, I've studied the anthropology, the sociology. I know what's going on here. And the media doesn't want to admit that this stuff is going on and is intensifying, because MSNBC and the White House are charging up racial tensions and charging up social tensions with class warfare and making double black unemployment what it was 6 years ago, and all the social problems be blamed on white people. And most of the white people being attacked are poor. They have done nothing to anybody. And in Los Angeles, especially, every day or two, a black person gets shot by Hispanic gangs. And the response of the Hispanic gangs are, we're tired of getting shot and being attacked, we're just going to kill everybody. The point is that the world, from Africa to Latin America to areas of Eastern Europe to many areas of Asia, is completely unraveling. I mean, you go to any country out there, and there are gangs of people going around killing each other. You look at Indonesia. There, it's the exact same people. They all look the same, same genetics, but they'll all kill each other over who lives on this side of the street or that side of the street. Or in Africa, it'll be animist or Muslims killing Christians. Or Christians, though, I got to be honest, statistically, they don't do a lot of it, killing those groups. It's black people. You live on that side of the river, you live on that side, we're going to kill each other. It's like the Star Trek episode where one guy's got black on his left side of the face, and the other guy's got black on the right side of his face, and one's the upper class and one's the lower class, and they're killing each other. This is divide and conquer, and I know you know that, but it's just amazing. Illegal immigrant deported six times charged in felony hit and run of family that injured young children. That's just, I mean, I see this every few hours. San Francisco sheriff, Pier 14 murder could happen in any U.S. city. He calls Trump an opportunist. See, it's no big deal this woman's dead. You know what? It's a good thing the sheriff's department, they're defending themselves. Yes, we're a sanctuary city, and if we have an aggravated felon who ICE wants to deport, who isn't a citizen, we're going to let him stay here. See, we can't even deport aggravated felons that are illegal. The Travis County sheriff is black and a Democrat. He deports on average five illegal aliens that are felons a week. He gives them to the feds. Most of the time, feds won't pick them up. And the Democratic Party is running people against him and trying to remove him, saying he's a racist. You're like, why? Because the precedent has to be set under globalism to have no border. And to have it where they can selectively keep anybody they want inside the country. And if you give in to the common sense, hey, we should deport illegals that are rapists and killers and arsonists and robbers, why, then you have to admit that there's an illegal alien crime wave. I mean, in the 80s, they admitted there was a Cuban crime wave. Not that Cubans were all criminals or predisposed to be criminals, but because Fidel Castro dumped 300 plus thousand people conservatively out of his prisons and put them on boats and said, go to El Norte in Florida. That was a crime wave. And they came into the Cuban communities that were there and took them over. That's not deniable. It's not racist to say the truth. Mexico is in a collapse crime wave. Venezuela is in a socialist crime wave collapse. The Soviet Union was under a horrible dictatorial permanent collapse system. Those are white people. It's not racist against Slavs to say they were under a tyranny. And I know you know that. It's not racist against Asians to say we shouldn't pay for Chinese women by the thousands a week to travel to the United States to openly declare they're here to have their babies and have it all paid for. This is suicide of this country. We're totally bankrupt. So I'm going to take this stack. And I'm going to put it over here. I'm going to spend a lot of the third hour on it. I didn't watch the nightly news one night last week. I tend to watch it in the morning on my iPad while I get on the elliptical. Then I've got, you know, televisions in there that I monitor as well in the gym, in the public gym I go to. And I heard them back there talking yesterday afternoon about a show they did last week. And I knew that we'd sent our East Coast reporter, Dan Bedondi, up there to cover it. And I heard dude talking about his uncle, who I know was a Navy SEAL and then a decorated FBI agent who retired a few years ago and is part of a big security firm. And I heard dude talking and I was like, are you kidding me? His uncle talking to other FBI people, who I guess are still in, was told, you ought to go check out Sandy Hook. We're not allowed to. It doesn't add up. And his uncle went to the hearings, and I didn't even realize we have video of him at the hearings and Bedondi interviewing him and what he said on air and what he said off air. And he told dude, yeah, you can repeat what I said. He's been in the John Gotti trial. He's a well-known FBI agent. He's been in a whole bunch of stuff, a bunch of big cases. And he told dude, I have never seen people acting so weird and so suspicious and saying no one knows anything and no paperwork on anything. He's a former Navy SEAL, retired FBI agent, and I know what'll happen. These guys are compartmentalized. They're like Mr. America, most of them. They really think they're the good guys. And overall, they are good guys, but they're compartmentalized. Right next to them is the devil. And above them, people like Eric Holder, as bad as it gets. They'll go investigate something, find out it's true, and then be shut down. And I would imagine after we talk about this, he's going to get a visit because he's now investigating Sandy Hook. Rob Dew's uncle is now investigating Sandy Hook, former FBI agent, retired. That's got to really freak him out. And I'm not going to put words in his mouth, but he said he's never seen something that looks this fake. It's because it is, folks. I don't know if they really killed kids. I don't know. But we got emails and memos. That school was shut down a year before. They tore it down. They covered it up. No rescue helicopters, no ambulances. Within an hour and a half, they had a sign saying, check in here. It was a media event. If they did kill kids, they knew it was coming. Stock the school with kids, killed him, and then had the media there. And that probably didn't even happen. I mean, no wonder we get so many death threats and so much heat and so much other stuff I'm not going to get into behind the scenes when we touch Sandy Hook, because, folks, it's as phony as a $3 bill. And what a small world that this happened. By the way, Rob Dew also had family in the Special Forces who was in the marathon at Boston and told us a bunch of stuff and then never talked to us again after got threatened, you name it. There was a drill, and they pulled him out right before the bomb went off. So it's what a small world it is that through Rob Dew's family, this stuff continues to come out. Rob Dew's kind of like been the hippie of the family, and now, you know, he works here, but he's a patriot libertarian. The rest of his family are, kind of like the, salt of the earth patriot types. But you get into it, and they're so naive until they run right into the reality. I mean, it all came out right before 9/11 and right after. But the FBI was blowing the whistle before 9/11 about the flight schools and being told to stand down. Same thing on 7/7. There were two FBI agents in the LA Times that saw the surveillance footage of McVeigh and eight other men stage the attack. And they went public and said this should be released and there should be investigation. And, of course, they basically got given desk jobs over it. But then they had other FBI agents go into the police department and threaten the head of the K-9 unit, Don Browning, highly decorated Marine Corps veteran from Vietnam. We've had him on three times. They walked right in and said, you and your wife are dead if you don't shut your mouth. And then he didn't shut up, so a month later, he's at the water cooler. And they walk in, walk right over to him and say, did you not get our first warning? Well, guess what? He still comes on this show, and he named the names. So suing! Oh, you're not going to sue the retired, decorated police officer, are you? Because you know it's true. So see, it's not that the whole government's bad. You got FBI trying to expose it's a false flag over here, and you got FBI right over here that's involved in it, at least in the cover-up, because you got the special units run by people like good old Eric Holder, who's now gone back to work at the big law firm that's the only law firm you can hire, like Arthur Anderson was for accountants, who if they certify what your company does, paying no taxes or getting bailouts, you never get prosecuted. He'll go there now and make millions a year for a job well done, screwing us over. Oh, but don't worry. He'll work for the Democrats in the state of Texas through a DOJ front to move to indict our attorney general because he's a patriot and not a crook. See, if you're a crook and work for them, you do fine. If you're not a crook, you get indicted. And Dr. Paul Craig Roberts has written an article about this today, how they can indict a ham sandwich, ladies and gentlemen. You can make one mistake on your income tax thing to put you under the jail, claiming you filed it and it's wire fraud. You waive all your rights when you fill it out, all of it. You can take 50 different tax returns to different, the same tax return to 50 different preparers. They'll give you 50 different answers. You make one mistake on something where the IRS won't even give you advice on how to fill it out properly. And then the FBI will come and have you indicted for a T that wasn't crossed, claiming you engaged in premeditated fraud. What a joke. The justice system at the federal level is defunct, illegitimate, not fit to attend toilets. Well, our government openly created ISIS out of Al-Qaeda. Now they say we can't fight them. We just got to have better ideas. Coming up, 10 killed, 55 wounded in 4th of July gun violence in Chicago. That's the Chicago Tribune. You mean black-on-black gang violence. No, let's blame the guns. That's all coming out in the third hour. And now it ties into the illegal alien crime wave. And police deny brutal beating of white man by black mob was racially motivated, even though that was put in the police report, it's now been removed. And that's like the San Francisco sheriff, because a Hispanic killed a white person. He's like defending himself and saying they've done nothing wrong, and they would release the illegal again. So it's really becoming a problem where white people, mainly liberal trendies, go into black areas and find out that it's not all as liberal and trendy as you know, as you thought. And this is the wages of MSNBC in the White House, where they're teaching young people it's virtuous to go out and attack a white person because they deserve it, because they've got it out to get you. So the problems in society never get fixed. And so folks that are into thug culture are primed to go into prison. Very, very sad for everybody. Coming up, London is now the global money laundering center of drug trade, says crime expert. Oh, but if you get caught selling a baggie of weed or something, you go to prison. But the banks are laundering trillions every year globally in drug money. Oh, that can't be investigated. I'm sorry, the Justice Department doesn't do that. Newsium poll, only 19% know First Amendment guarantees freedom of religion. Yeah, I want to send our reporters out. They've been doing a great job. Why don't we send Jakari out, see if he wants to go cover this, and ask folks if they know what the First Amendment is, and see which percentage know that it's about the press, religion, speech, everything. See how many people know what the First Amendment is. And then ask them about the poll. We have a Leanne McAdoo report coming up where she goes out and asks folks about Greece and their collapse, and are they concerned. And I noticed most people wanted to say Greece was lazy and deserved it. They didn't want to talk about, are they worried about a collapse here? They wanted to say they need to pay their debts. Really? Debts they didn't sign on to? America is in deeper debt than Greece is overall. And you watch these people sit there and shoot their mouths off. One black guy gets it right and says it's an aristocracy running it, not a democracy in Greece. Greece meltdown is America next. It's up on Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. Lord Christopher Monckton, one of the main leaders of UKIP, is joining us. The leader of UKIP, Nigel Farage, member of the EU Parliament, has said we're watching the beginning of the end of the EU project. I want to look at the EU and what it is and actually what they maneuvered Greece into. Clearly, Greece is partly to blame for allowing government to sign them on to derivatives, to invest their pension funds in global equities and things that were questionable. But we're just as guilty of it here. And then coming up at the bottom of the third hour, Rob Dew is coming in. His uncle was a former Navy SEAL, is a retired FBI agent. He got directed by insiders to investigate Sandy Hook. He actually went to the hearings on it and said he's never seen anything like it. He's never seen people more secretive, and he's been in John Gotti mob trials. So he says it's the spookiest, sneakiest, what was the exact word? Strangest thing he's ever seen. I'm telling you, folks, I didn't say it was staged at first, and I got a lot of criticism just because I can't believe they're this bold. Man, they're bold. Man, they're bold. And then I just can't believe what a small world it is that Rob Dew would end up going and doing this. I did an anemic 30-second plug at the end of the last hour, and we can't even pay the bills doing that around here. And the reason I keep harping on sold out, sold out, sold out of our best-selling line is we sell books, videos, T-shirts, high-quality water filters, shortwave radios, non-GMO seeds at very competitive prices. Cook stove, survival food of the highest quality from my Patriot at InfoWarsStore.com. But you get in a catch-22 where some products sell out, some don't, and then you buy a whole bunch of something to stockpile it, and then it doesn't sell, and then you buy other groups of something, and it all sells out, and you're like, that's great, but I'm sold out for 4 to 8 weeks or whatever it is, depending on the product. Now we don't have the capital we need. I mean, look at what's sold out. BrainForce sold out in 4 days. LiverShield sold out in a week. Prostaguard sold out in a month. Child-E sold out in 2 months. Took us 6 months to get that. Occupower sold out. And it's because we use so many non-GMO, high-quality concentrates the manufacturers are the most respected, but they always go, hey, if you just go down a grade or wouldn't demand to have this, we could do it right now. So I'm proud of the fact our products are so good. But there's a reason most vitamins and minerals and stuff are just one thing, because it's hard enough just to get that. Well, we have Survival Shield X2, but it will sell out, and it could be a long time till we get more in because we're having trouble securing the Deep Earth iodine. Super Male Vitality is about to sell out. Super Female is about to sell out within the week. Oxy Powder selling out, and that's provided by Group. He's selling out. InfoWarsLife.com. Secret 12 Methylcobalamin is in stock. Silver Bullet in stock. Oral Oregano in stock. That was out for a while. High quality concentrated from the Mediterranean, the highest quality type. Winter Sun, vitamin D3 in stock, DNA Force in stock, Lung Cleanse in stock. And those are all excellent products and have been out of stock before. It doesn't denote that something is bad if it's not sold out. It's just that your purchase of the products, they're super high quality, is essential to funding our operation as well. So if you buy those other products, I'll have the money to buy the other products. I need to get back in. It just shows how I've never gotten enough into the black to get into a position where I always have enough in stock to not be partially behind the eight ball. I mean, I haven't done a money bomb in 3 years because we haven't needed to. I may actually do one just to make sure that we've got enough to launch the TV network and a bunch of other issues. But your purchases are absolutely essential to our operations. Your PrisonPlanet.tv memberships. Shop with the good folks. Help fund the Patriots. I want to thank you all for your support. InfoWarsStore.com or 888-253-3139. Free shipping in the month of July. What is the European Union? How did the United Kingdom ever get brought into it without having a vote? Well, how did we get put into the Trans-Pacific Partnership without a say? This is the nature of global governance. What is the EU? What is global governance? Why is it promoting global carbon taxes? Well, to fund itself. Lord Christopher Monckton was one of the top advisors and in the cabinet of Margaret Thatcher. He's a best-selling author and researcher, a top inventor, and is no stranger to this audience. He'll just be with us till the bottom of the hour, maybe a little bit more if he has time. But I wanted to get his take specifically on what's happening in Greece, because from my perspective, whether Greece gets bailed out or not, the EU is designed to create financial crisis to consolidate nation states. Just 2 years ago, the EU announced a move to get the nation states like France and Spain and others to not even call their national teams the French or the Spanish, but to give them now basically dinosaur and superhero names and mythical names, because even the idea of having national teams is xenophobic and bad. See, political correctness is to kill any national independent ideology. And when you research deeper, most of Greece's so-called debt is globalist bank-run derivatives that have been signed onto. And separately, we have the announcements they're going to bail in and take money out of people's bank accounts. China has started doing that. That happened, of course, a few years ago there in the Mediterranean as well in Cyprus. And now banks are making similar announcements and preparations here. And they're acting like cash is illegal. So this is a very dangerous situation we're in. Some say it could bring down the whole world economy. I wanted to get the perspective of a man who's been, again, at the highest levels of government, been an editor of a major newspaper, studied the financial situation in Greece, is one of the main opponents of the European dictatorship. Lord Monckton, thank you for joining us.
Well, Alex, it's a pleasure to be with you. And in a way, I could say I told you so, because in 1996, I gave a lecture to the faculties of economics and of international relations at the University of St. Andrews here in Scotland. And what I said was, look, the euro is going to fail. Now, it didn't even start for 3 years after that, but already I knew it was going to fail because they didn't understand the elementary economics of trying to put together an area with a single currency. You have to have nations who are all more or less kind of economically competent at the same level. This is known as the economics of optimal currency areas. Now, these words are simply not known by the average politician. And as a result, they sailed ahead with the euro when it couldn't possibly work. Now it's failed. But here's the warning. If this one has failed, imagine how much bigger the failure will be when the UN gets its way in Paris this December and sets up a world government, which is like the EU, but on a global scale, with no escape for anyone. At least at the moment, if you don't like the EU, you can get out and go to the States or go to somewhere, Canada, Australia. You don't have to be in the EU. But if there's a global government, there's no escape unless you've got a spaceship. And the problem is that these politically correct people you were talking of, the people who think there is only one view, and that's the Marxist view, and nothing else should be allowed to prevail, these people are dangerous. It was they who captured the European Union. They didn't actually set it up, but they captured it very quickly after it was set up. As you know, the KGB was largely instrumental in founding the euro-dollar market and had a lot of influence on shaping the creation of the euro because they knew that the euro would undermine the economies of the EU, which it's now doing, even though Britain is outside the EU. We are threatened by the bankruptcy of Greece, because this could bring down a house of cards with Portugal, Spain, Ireland, even France, Italy, Belgium, all these countries, Poland. They're all running massive debts. They're all in serious financial trouble.
Lord Monckton,
financial trouble that's made worse by the euro.
You call it the EU dictatorship. You just don't use that word lightly. That's not rhetoric. Explain to them why you call it a dictatorship and what percentage of UK laws are now by imperial edict from the shadow bureaucracy.
That's right. Now, 5 laws out of every 6 that are made in the United Kingdom and inflicted upon us are made because the unelected commissars of the European Union, who have the sole right to propose legislation for the whole of Europe, and that legislation takes precedence over all our own domestic legislation, they have to do what the commissars tell us to do. Commissar is the official German name for the 30 people who, behind closed doors, run Europe. They have absolute power, enormous wealth, and no responsibility. These are the people who now dictate to us what our laws shall be. Democracy has gone from within the European Union. It will go from the world as a whole if the EU and the UN get together at Paris, as they are already planning to do, to set up a world government in the name of saving the planet from
global climate. I want to talk about that world government, because they tried 5-6 years ago. You were there, got the secret document. Of course, you got no credit. It was just devastating victory. It was like winning a major war, stopping that global government treaty that they tried to keep secret. They're keeping TPP secret. But now more and more, the Pope's calling for global governance on climate change. It seems the whole system and their operatives are coming out being honest, at least on the surface, that yes, it's global government, but they're selling it as something to save people. But you talk about how they use the Soviet or communist German name Commissar for their political officers. The Commissars, of course, were the political police in the Soviet Union under Obama. This is mainstream news. The Pentagon in 2010 said they're, quote, preparing to arrest libertarians and conservatives. This is actually in the Army document, and put them in, quote, re-education camps. It actually says re-education camps. So fantastical, so over the top.
Well, again, this is the danger, because not only have you got the entire governing class now ganging up on the people in individual nations. I mean, look at your Supreme Court. It got one out of its 3 big decisions right, and look how badly wrong the other 2 were. You have the Supreme Court, unelected by anyone, effectively making new law contrary to the Constitution.
Unprecedented.
Contrary to its obligations. And why are they all doing this? Why is the Pentagon joining in and saying, right, we're going to lock up the likes of Monckton and Jones in re-education camps? Why are they doing this?
Well, that was my point. I'm not joking. I feel like a liar when I say that because it sounds so outrageous, but I can show people the mainstream article in the Army document. Why would they use terms like commissar and re-education? I mean, they're using actual totalitarian terminology. They're not even hiding it. Why?
Because they think they've got away with it, and they may have got away with it. The problem is that at Paris in December, which is the really big climate conference, this is the big push where the entire kind of communist group worldwide is getting together and has captured most governments. Now, in fact, very nearly all governments, I think, are going to sign this agreement. Now, the one thing that needs to be in that agreement to stop it setting up a world government is a clause the same as the clause that's in the Kyoto Protocol, which preceded this one. And the Kyoto Protocol of 1997, which America didn't sign under Al Gore as president of the Senate, because 95 out of 100 senators voted it down. But even that protocol at least contained what's called a freedom clause. It's a secession clause, technically, is the name for it. It means that any country after 6 months or a year who doesn't like the obligations under the Kyoto Protocol can simply give notice and break free. Canada's done it, Russia's done it, Japan's done it. Several others, I think, will do it when they get the chance. But what is now being proposed is a treaty like the European treaties, which have no escape clauses. Once you're in, you are subject to the alien power, whether you like it or not, whether your voters like it or not, whether your Congress likes it or not. That's why this really is the end of democracy. It's the end of democracy, not just in some sort of general hand-waving, eye-rolling sense. It's the end of democracy because the law in future will make sure that the supreme law that applies to the United States after Paris will be the law made by what at the moment, the treaty draft, because I have seen it, is calling a governing body. Now, 6 years ago at Copenhagen, which you mentioned earlier, they called it a government. They're now calling it a governing body, but it's going to have even bigger powers of government than the government they were going to establish in Copenhagen. And much of it is already in place. They've just quietly steamed ahead, regardless of the defeat at Copenhagen, and put 1,000 new international bureaucracies in place, all interlocking with one another. The Pentagon talks to them, of course, the EU is in there. And there's now 1,000 of these bureaucracies, which together will form the sinews, the enforcement arm, if you like, of this new hideous totalitarian global government. And all of this, of course, based on the climate lie, just as the European Union was based on the lie that the Soviet Union would otherwise pull Europe apart. In fact, NATO was already guaranteeing the security of Europe. We didn't need the European Union for that. And indeed, if anything, it has increased the risk of tension and war in Europe rather than reducing it.
Absolutely. And you were right telling Thatcher that 30 years ago. It's certainly been proven true. Moving forward, as we're about to go to break, sir, and again, Lord Christopher Monckton joins us. So undoubtedly, do you agree with the point I've made and others are saying that this is the moment that they uncloak, admit world government, still deceive on the details, but basically emerge? I mean, it looks like this is the big assault. This is the next big phase, the big takeover. This is the big assault.
This is the moment when they think they're going to get away with setting up a world government. And after the break, I'll tell you how we're going to stop them.
It's an epic time to be alive, folks, because we're not just being conquered by some, you know, advanced civilization or something. We're being conquered by tyranny. Lord Monckton will be with us till about 45 after, and then I'm going to
Big Bad John.
Get into the latest on Jade Helm, where the mainstream media is misrepresenting what we're saying. We've never said it's an imminent military takeover. We've said what our own military sources have told us, that it is just further acclimation to have troops on the streets of America. Not to counter ISIS or Al-Qaeda, but to counter citizens during a state-level insurrection. And that means the states taking their gold back from the Federal Reserve, things like that, that you now see happening. I told you the new governor in Texas knows what's going on. Look at this headline. We're training ISIS. White House website contradicts Obama's speech blooper. Now, I've been asked Lord Monckton about ISIS and it being out of control and why the West allowed it to get out of control and what he thinks about it in the next segment, but I just wanted to mention that now, that things are really starting to unravel with this narrative. when Obama says we shouldn't be bombing them, when the truth is they're really the Free Syrian Army that we helped arm. I mean, this is a big scandal about to break, in my view. But Lord Monckton was just joining us, probably the chief EU critic in the world, helped beef up and promote UKIP, that's now one of the fastest growing parties in the world. Nigel Farage is saying he believes that we're seeing the beginning of the breakup of the EU. We'll get Lord Monckton's take on that. But global government, from the TPP to the Atlantic Treaty, all of it's being welded together now, and the taxing authority for it, the carbon tax, is being pushed. That's why they'll never give it up, no matter how discredited it is. So, Lord Monckton, you were saying before the break, we can stop it. You, going to the alternative press, literally parachuting in Durban, South Africa, when they wouldn't let you in, that stunt getting attention, you more than anybody, I know you don't want credit, but it's credit to humanity, credit to the individual taking action. Undoubtedly, if you didn't get the secret text of Copenhagen, undoubtedly, if you didn't pull stunts to expose it, undoubtedly, if the cops didn't beat you up and bring attention to what was happening, a lot of this stuff would have gotten through. So when you say we can stop the formation of open world government, I'm listening. What do we do?
Right. The first thing is we're going to have to set up our own parallel freedom institutions worldwide. And the most important of these is a currency. If we take away their power to issue currency because we do it better than they do, then we'll stop them. When I gave that lecture in 1996 in St. Andrews University, I said the euro is just another me too fiat currency, no assets in the bank to prop it up. In fact, now it has negative assets in the bank propping it up. But if we were to set up our own currency, people would rush to use it. You can now make a currency of your own. It's no longer illegal. They can't stop you. As long as you don't print it or mint it, you just have it as an electronic instrument of saving against which you can switch your credit card, so you can spend on it just as if you were spending in dollars. Then we can stop inflation in its tracks. We can take currency away from central banks and put it back in the hands of the people and make a fortune doing it, Alex. You and I could do this very well. I've been studying this for some years. I'm now just about ready to start. That is step one, which is that there's got to be our own independent currency.
I totally agree, and more transparent than Bitcoin. I'm not attacking Bitcoin.
Oh, yeah, no, Bitcoin I would attack because it is simply, there's no assets at the back of that. That's why 78% of the value of Bitcoins was wiped out just last year alone. And the person who set it up committed suicide. It is a nightmare because they didn't do it right. What it shows is there's a huge demand for anything that isn't a government.
And imagine one based on universal liberty and freedom, promoting libertarian enlightenment ideas. Everyone would politically support it. And if it was backed by something real, explain this to me, it would be, yes, a sensation.
Certainly. You come to me with your Mickey Mouse dollars or euros or pounds, and I give you, let's call it the talent in return, and that would be simply an electronic unit of currency, just like a unit in a unit fund. And there would be fund managers who manage the fund that represents the talents I've given you. So you give me your dollars. I don't want to hold dollars because they're going to inflate away. So what I do is I spend those dollars quick, the day you give them to me, buying assets that go into the fund so that the entire currency is completely self-funding. And it's enormously profitable.
That'd be the first currency to ever do that in history that wasn't fiat or based in gold.
Give you an example. There was the Mark Banco in Hamburg, which operated for 250 years until about 1800. And that was so stable because it was based on silver. It was always about 103%.
This is so exciting. Stay there. Let's talk about it, Lord Monckton, when we come back. Long segment coming up. We'll also give you his website when we return. I'm Alex Jones, Infowars.com. I want to just take a moment here to thank God.
Got the number 13.
For the providence that free peoples throughout history have been given. And I want to thank God for the gift of consciousness and being alive on this planet. I don't want listeners to think I'm a negative person. There's so much good, so much creativity, so much beauty, so much honor in this world. But good men and women tend to be very restrained and not take action, almost like embarrassed to be aggressive or to give alternative ideas, and we just kind of quietly sit there and have our own lives, our own friends, and recluse from the system. If we do that, we're going to lose everything, because as I ended the last segment, this tyranny we face is not like the Romans, for all their barbarous problems, conquering an area and bringing aqueducts and science and overall improving life generally. You could argue that being conquered by the Romans, if you were saying what's modern Switzerland today, turned out to be a good thing. In some cases, they weren't consciously trying to destroy everything, is the point. They were very abusive, very tyrannical. I'm not endorsing Roman civilization. You look at the elites we have today, they instinctively are just very twisted people. The ideology is anti-family, anti-stability. Why would our government fund ISIS to take over the Middle East and destabilize things and kill every Christian they find and blow up every church they find? I mean, our government's had some problems in the past, but I guarantee you Ronald Reagan wouldn't do that. I guarantee you John F. Kennedy wouldn't do that, or Dwight D. Eisenhower. I mean, I don't romanticize these people, but we truly have new levels of corruption. The boss hogs that ran this country, LBJ, as corrupt as he was, would have never signed on to a TPP waiving Congress's power. They were territorial. This was their country they were running. So we have traitors in our midst. And I agree with Lord Monckton. They think they've got full control now of the major nation states. And it's why they're just moving at warp speed right now. And their operatives are activating everywhere. I know Lord Monckton's a Catholic. I have a lot of Catholic friends. I don't get into the whole Catholic or Protestant fight. I'm just a Christian. But this new pope activating and saying we need global government for, you know, the carbon taxes. I mean, I don't know what they got on him or what's going on, but that's got to be decried. People are really showing which side they're on right now. This is the big move. And, I mean, there's the headline. Pope Francis calls for a new system of global government to tackle climate change. That's not an Infowars.com headline. That's in Time Magazine, Newsweek, the BBC. I mean, Lord Monckton, how do you square this?
What has happened here is that Pope Francis was brought up in the communist tradition of what's called liberation theology, which came out of the French universities, like so many other bad ideas, and it was taken back to Latin America by students for the priesthood who'd gone to study for university degrees in France. And, of course, one of those was Pope Francis. So he is an anti-capitalist through and through. He realizes the power of this environmental issue in two directions. One, as a way of rallying his fellow communists everywhere, and the other, as a way of getting himself to the high table. He's going to go to the UN and address the General Assembly, and they're going to cheer him to the echo because, of course, the UN, just like the EU, uses the climate as an excuse to gather more powers to itself. Now, the Pope wants to be part of that. And so what he's doing is repositioning the church as an entity which no longer opposes communism. Now, instead, it opposes capitalism. And this is really, I think, a mistake. If you were going to get into politics at all, you should certainly oppose communism and any other kind of totalitarianism. But the Pope is now, he's now come out in his true colors. He said, right, I am a communist. I want a communist world government. I want to be one of those in charge of it. And if anyone disagrees, then you know that's bad. Well, we have to stand against this, and we have to say, with every respect to the Pope, respect to his office anyway, that this is not the way forward. Communism killed 100 million people. Conservatively, it's still killing people today. The climate change thing is already killing people as well, as they can't afford to heat or keep cool their homes, whichever climate they live in, because of absurdly high electricity prices. Global warming, even if it were to go to the sort of levels that the extremists predict of 3 or 4 Celsius degrees by the end of this century, which it won't, there hasn't been any this century at all, would not do very much harm. What will do harm is the global government that the Pope and the UN and most governments in the world are determined to establish. What we've got here is the entire governing class worldwide ganging up against the people. Now, here's the trick, Alex. What we've got to do is, you can moan about it all you like, but that won't achieve anything. What we've got to do is to accept that we have ultimately the money that they depend on. We have the numbers as well. They don't. And so what we need to start doing is increasingly taking the government of our own nation and of the world into our hands, the hands of the free peoples of the world, and say to our governments, no, we do not want Islam to become the normal political setup. Let it be confined to being a religion. We want a democratic political setup by which the people decide what shape their government will take, and not the governing class taking those decisions. And this is why I was talking earlier of the idea of establishing.
And I want to get to that, but since you raised that point, the head, what you're mentioning, the head of EU security came out 3 days ago in a speech and also in an article and said we should have Islam as the political governing system, basically. So first they remove Christianity from society, even though it wasn't governing. It was an idea that helped guide things, you know, kind of like streetlights at night. Now they're saying we should be absorbed by Islam. Why is there a suicidal bent by the leftist in Western civilization? They rule it. They've taken it over. It's the engine of prosperity. Is there such an instinctive hatred of it that they have to execute it as some act of galactic vandalism, A? And then B, Lord Mog,
to understand one thing about the left, which is absolutely crucial to understand, and that is that the left's ambition is to keep the poor poor, because the poor, stupidly, vote left. The capitalist's ambition, the freedom-loving libertarian's ambition, is to make everybody rich so that they won't vote left. That's the fundamental divide in politics. The totalitarians want to keep people poor so that they can push them around.
But we will make people rich. It always works if they just get out of our way.
They don't want to do that. They want to run everything. Fingertip control. The very word totalitarian means they want to control every tiny last little detail of our lives, down to the last flickering, unreadable by poison-filled mercury light bulb. That's how they are. They cannot bear the idea of allowing people to take decisions for themselves. And the one thing that they are frightened of is people who are independent enough to do that.
That's right.
So if we, for instance, set up our own currency, if we set up our own parallel peoples, united democracies, forget the United Nations, let's have the United Democracies, and let's start setting up a complete parallel set of global institutions that are governed not by the governing class, but by the votes of the people who wish to participate. And the left will find that very hard to take over, because as long as we keep it democratic, they can't stop us.
That's right. Explain a little bit about how the UN and these other bodies are totalitarian, because they always put provisos in, like Article 30 of the UN Charter, that says all these rights are null and void whenever we feel like it. But let's go back to a question I didn't quite get out to you. So for 30 years, they've said you're wrong. There's no move towards covert global socialist communist government. For 20 years, they've told me I'm wrong. For 30-something years, they've told Ron Paul he's wrong. For 50 years, they told Barry Goldwater he was wrong. Now this covert plan is in the headlines. I had Nightline here 4 years ago. I had CBS Nightly News here 2 years ago. I don't even take the interviews anymore because they always distort them. And they look at me and I show them all these articles, all these clips of world leaders, Gordon Brown, you name it, calling for global government, Herman Von Rompuy, Bill Clinton. And they looked at me and they said, that's a different global government than you're talking about. And then went on to say I was insane on television. So how do they square? There is no world government. There is. Al Gore was in Congress, as you know, 8 years ago and said there is no move for a carbon tax, and then proposed it a year later. What is this tactic of saying 2 + 2 = 5, raising debt limit doesn't raise debt limit? If we've been exposing global governments coming, it's bad, it's totalitarian, they deny it, now it's here. How do they then not become discredited? How do they just make this shift, and why are they making the shift?
Three words, Ion Mihai Pacepa. Now, he was the head of the Securitate, which was the secret police in Ceausescu's communist Romania about 30 years ago. Now, he was part of the largest directorate of the KGB, which was known as the Disinformatia Directorate, the Disinformation Directorate. That directorate had 1 million Western communists who were not known to be communists, not known to be working with the KGB, who were in the West, beavering away in the BBC, in the CBC, in the NBC, in the ABC, all the big TV networks, all the big newspapers, all the big industries, all the big trade unions, all the big churches. They were everywhere, making sure that when the moment came, and the moment has now come,
oh, good God,
every one of these institutions would already have been taken over by communists. And let's use this word communist rather more freely than we have in the past, because after the McCarthy era, it was kind of not fashionable to use the word communist. But now that's the word we have to use. These are Marxists. These are people who wish to control us, and we do not wish to be controlled by them. They, unfortunately, control the overwhelming majority of the news media, which is why your program exists, Alex. There'd be no need for it if the news media were doing their job. So because of this extraordinary degree of control that these million agents managed to obtain, and which they continued to operate even after the KGB had gone, this was a sort of self-perpetuating organization. Effectively, we on the free market end of things didn't organize. We didn't organize in the same way.
Well, it was more disinformation that they completely fell. They did fall because the engine failed, but by then they'd already metastasized other cancers into us, now they're manifesting.
They'd already quietly taken over our major institutions. The BBC is a very good
example. And they are at war with families and wealth, and they admit Cloward and Piven. They want everybody poor so the Commissars can sit around at their duchies like kings over us. This is the new royalty. This is the new French Revolution.
That's it. It's an aristocracy of blackguards. It's exactly what they've been planning all along. And this is a huge attack by the governing class, which is now largely left-wing, on the people. And the people are going to have to get organized in various ways. And Alex, you're going to be a very important part of this, because we're literally going to have to establish a resistance movement, just like the French Resistance, because that's the kind of regime we're going to end up with.
You're right.
If this carries on. Already they are more and more openly and more frequently demanding that the likes of me, who dare to do scientific research and publish papers in leading scientific journals raising questions about their new religion of global warming,
be arrested.
They're increasingly saying we must be tried, imprisoned, and executed.
Well, that's right. They've now changed their tone. In the last month, there's been five articles I've seen seriously saying, shut me off the air and I'm dangerous. And they never used to talk like that. I mean, they're very naked now. And I agree. I believe they're about to make their move.
They're naked because they think they're very near to power. They think that Paris is going to do it for them. And at the moment, that's right, because we have governments who are intellectually enfeebled. I mean, people like David Cameron, he's a smooth operator, but he doesn't really believe anything or know anything or understand, because he wasn't from that generation that you and I were. We had to fight the communists to eventually prevail over them. He didn't have to do that. So he thinks he can sit back and be part of this world government, and somehow it will be a capitalist government on the night. Well, no, it won't. It will be another totalitarian government somewhere between fascism and corporatism and communism. And if we don't stop it, it will take control over every detail of our lives. Already they're fiddling the data, fiddling the temperature records, fiddling everything, so as to try to pretend that what they now perfectly well know isn't happening with the climate is happening, because without
Well, they've already done it. They don't call it warming. They call it climate change. Promise us you'll come on from Paris. I'm tempted to go to Paris and Greece next month to cover all this. In fact, I'm looking at it, doing it right now. But thank you so much, Lord Monckton. Give us your website.
It's been a pleasure. Go to scienceandpublicpolicy.org. That's the best one to go to. Or whatsupwiththat.com, whatsupwiththat.com. Either of those, you'll find plenty of material from me on the climate question. So God bless you, Alex, and God bless America.
Thank you very much, sir. Well, he's never minced words before, but that was his strongest words. And that's not rhetoric. Global totalitarianism, it's on. fascist on top, communist on the bottom, because the globalists are exempt from the communist hell they'll put over the nation states. Diplomatic and political immunity. The new royalty. We are in big trouble. Big trouble. And we're going to have to mobilize. I mean, they want revolution against the police to start a civil war. Communist playbook all the way. Briefly, Anthony Gucciardi had a great idea today. We have people beating down the walls. The reviews are coming in. We ordered a limited amount of Brain Force, the ultimate brain boost formula. Not with GMO, not with chemicals, not with herbs that make you high, but stuff that just gives you the chemicals your brain already needs to operate normally. And I ran out of this on Friday. Thank God the truck came in over the weekend and got more. I take two tablets a day. You can take three tablets a day. Brain Force, it's going to be sold out for, it looks like, 4 weeks. It's being manufactured, being produced right now here in the USA. People don't want to sign up for the list. I mean, they are, to be emailed when it's back in. They want to pre-order it, phone calls, beating down our doors. So by the end of the show, it'll be at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com. You can go to the site and you can go ahead and just order, and then you will be secured the bottle, because it looks like what we're manufacturing will probably sell out in about a week or two when it comes in. But it's a catch-22 with all our other expenses. We don't have the money to order a huge amount and then gamble and not be able to sell it. So we have a limited amount coming in. If you want to be secured your brain force, InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. You can order or sign up to be emailed when it comes back in at InfoWarsLife.com. We'll be back. We are facing a French Revolution takeover, the opposite of our revolution. They saw the revolution happening here, so they piggybacked a few years after. And they were going to abolish the family. They were inverting everything, literally. Crosses upside down. It was basically satanic. They were demanding women have sex with the leaders of it. They were going to set themselves up as the new gods. It was occultic in nature. The Jacobins and others. And that's where all this modern system comes from. It's a power cult. It's a devil cult. And if you look at the hammer and sickle, the red flag, all of that comes out of it. It doesn't come from Marx and Engels. Why do you have the mega rich funding communism? Because they administer it offshore. Coming up, Rob Dew is going to be in the studio. We're going to play the video with Dan Badondi, a reporter, going to the hearings at Sandy Hook and interviewing Rob Dew's uncle, who was former Navy SEAL, former FBI agent, retired, works in a major security firm. He said he wanted to investigate it, and he's investigating it now, and said he's never seen anything like it. What a small world. Rob Dew didn't even spur him to go do this. He talked to colleagues in the FBI, others, and they said, no, this needs to be looked at. We can't do it. You go look at it. The former state police officer ran one of the biggest school security firms in the country. Went there and investigated it and said, oh, my God, it's not real. I mean, it's, you know, Wolfgang Halbig. I didn't believe it was staged at first, but, I mean, it's just the official story is not true. That's what I know. And they're hiding something. So that's all coming up. And I'm going to get into the unprecedented illegal alien crime wave that just they get out of jail free cards. And how that ties into the other things that are happening. I mean, Bernie Sanders, folks, is now the front runner basically against Hillary. And I don't think Bernie Sanders is an evil guy. Hillary is evil. But Bernie Sanders would ruin this country if he got control of it. And it just shows how the Democrats are desperate for anything. He'll criticize the big banks. He'll criticize the bailouts. But Bernie, big government spending and entitlements is what got us into this, buddy. No, do the math. No amount of money will ever prop all this up, Bubba. The bankers want that. So we're going to break that down. The German siege of Greece has begun. No, this is not a repeat of their invasion of 41. Did you notice that Greece creditors are not rushing to offer the Greeks a new deal? in the wake of the stunning referendum result on Sunday? No. We're going to go over all of that, and I'm going to get into Jade Helm with Rob Dew as well. It's now getting ready to commence, now getting ready to take place, and our point man on this is going to be former Staff Sergeant Joe Biggs breaking it all down. Now, well, we're already into hour number three. Coming up in the next segment, I don't even know what to call this, just the propaganda war legitimizing criminal activity. You got whites getting attacked everywhere, and the media covers it up that it's racial. You got a much bigger crime wave of illegals just pouring in by the millions, a lot of them criminals, running from crimes they've committed, raping, shooting, murdering, and doubling down by the sheriff in San Francisco saying, we didn't do anything wrong. Releasing a felon, seven-time felon, deported five times. We need ICE to get in there and do their job, as if, and in a way that's true, because ICE won't do its job, but then you won't turn people over to them. I mean, you can Google Travis County Sheriff under fire for deportations, and then you read it's felons. Five a week on average are deported. And the Democrats want a black Democrat removed. And now Obama has, quote, scaled back immigration deportations. Well, it already happened over a year ago. There's basically almost no deportations except for super hardcore felons out of the country. And then for visual optics, a few thousand here and there of millions. And they'll deport people that try to go in and stay here legally. Like, I'm always hearing about engineers who have family here or who have married somebody, and then they'll say it's a sham marriage and send them out of the country. But then if you want to come here from, again, the biggest group of immigrants now is not Mexicans, Chinese, and you come here and have your baby openly, you have the baby 2 weeks after you arrive, you come, you get your extended stay. It's in the news how they do it. You have your baby, it's all paid for. And then if I don't want to pay for it, I'm racist. Can I go to China and say, I'm here to have my baby? I want my free everything. I mean, it's crazy. And what's really got me angry about this is the Donald. The criticisms of Donald Trump that he's racist. I mean, I've got articles here where Hispanic immigrant laborers, being legal aliens, working on the new Trump building don't know they want to be around him or work for him. I mean, that's an issue right there. We should investigate Trump. Does he have any illegals working for him? And again, I'm not even against the average person that's up here wanting a better life. The point is that the large minority of the people that are criminals or are milk of the system need to be kicked out. I mean, if you can't kick them out, then you don't even have a country. This is Chumpville we're talking about. I mean, I can't go to Mexico or Guatemala or Nicaragua or El Salvador or Colombia or Venezuela or Brazil or Chile, let's just go south, and show up and ask for free stuff. They will laugh at you. But you got these big banks and globalist groups that are financing. I mean, J.P. Morgan runs the food stamp program, makes the money off of it, takes the taxpayer money. They're behind it all. Donald Trump's signature collection, made in Mexico. Yeah, and I think Donald Trump will argue, yeah, those are good seamstress people working in Mexico. I'm all for trade. I'm all for open business, because they're now going after him, saying he's a hypocrite making stuff in Mexico. I actually buy coffee from Mexico because it's the best coffee, according to my palate, and it helps local farmers. I'm not against helping people in Mexico. That's the answer. But now the media is going after Trump. In fact, where was that article from? That's an interesting find. That Huffington Post, and what are they saying? Let me see the headline, please. Donald Trump gets his stuff made in Mexico by those lazy people. He didn't say that. He said the bad are coming up here in some cases. Internet reminds Donald Trump his signature collection is made in Mexico. Yeah, that's what I'm seeing from Huffington Post and Raw Story is like, Hispanics are hurt that Donald Trump says they're lazy. Donald Trump didn't say that. I'm sick of you liars. It's incredible. It's incredible. Amazing. Coming up, officials forced to deny fake news story about white supremacist murder of black teens. Hoax article receives an astonishing 21,000 Facebook shares. And that ties into the disinfo campaign that's been launched that we're going to be breaking down here in just a few minutes. Before we get to that, I want to just mention some of the news that's coming up after we break this down. We're training ISIL. White House website corrects Obama's speech blooper. President's embarrassing error during press briefing amended on official transcript. Well, our government is funding ISIL. It's not a blooper. It's a Freudian slip. Gay marriage state agency orders Christians to stop talking about their faith. See, now the tolerance is over. That was only for the takeover. Now you shut up. Christians denied First Amendment rights for refusing to cater to gay wedding. So that's coming up as well. And then we've got this amazing article out of Vanity Fair. Is this creepy real-life secret society the key to True Detective Season 2? And then they mesh reality with unreality. And I guess Matthew McConaughey's popular TV show, I don't know, I don't watch it, with the fact that Bohemian Grove is weird and is creepy. Because used to, they would just deny it existed when I'd cover it 15, 16 years ago. And at first they said my infiltration was fake and wasn't real. And then they admitted, okay, he snuck in, we'd like to arrest him. And then I went in there with Brad Metzler's people, and they arrested them. I didn't stop. I ran and jumped in the river and swam off. So, of course, they didn't show that at the end of the show. They threatened to indict everybody if they didn't refuse to show that. And why? Because it looks super Rambo, me jumping in the Russian River and evading them and swimming down the river and climbing out. And climbing around when the police were trying to get me. I mean, big deal. I'm a journalist going to cover what's going on in there. I knew they'd blown our cover. I told them they had moles inside their group, that the police were waiting on us. I hung back and said, I wouldn't go in there if I was you. I was not technically on their property. They came out, the police, to snatch him with private security, and I escaped. I've had like four or five people the last 2 days on the street bring that up, so I guess they're re-airing that on Discovery Channel. But I know a setup when I see one, and it didn't take much. We were shooting interviews for it at this old Gothic-style theater there in Monterio, a little town. And one of the people, locals they'd hired, they were openly talking about how we were about to infiltrate it that day. And one of the locals was telling me he thought it was wrong that we were exposing it, that he worked there. And I said, hey, that guy's going to drop a dime on us if he hadn't already done it. I don't think we should sneak in today. We should sneak in the morning. And I said, they're still going to be waiting now. They said, don't be a conspiracy theorist, Alex. The director did. Dummy, come on. And the guy was wearing a hat, a ball cap that said CIA. And he thought it was freaking me out that he was wearing the ball cap. I was just like, give me a break, man. It's like one time David Knight went in to interview the head UT professor on Agenda 21. He heads their program. And the guy, like, was it David Knight or was it Melissa Melton? I know they told me about it. I think it was David Knight. It was Melissa. Turns the coffee cup towards them and goes, you know I know the CIA. Oh, you mean the CIA might get us? Oh, no. We better not have whistleblowers on Benghazi and lieutenant colonels exposing it day one and Navy SEAL families exposing how you murdered them and government narcotics trafficking and child kidnapping rings. Oh, you mean they might get us? Oh, you mean we're going to all get real scared now? I love how these people always try to scare us, even their camp followers and minions. Like, we're like them. Like, we don't know how dangerous this is. It's just funny. It's like telling some face jumper who's jumping off a 50-story building, hey, you know, you could die doing that. They always do that. But at the same time, I wasn't going to have them indict me for trespassing when I didn't trespass. I hung back. I know state law. I looked it up on the riverbank and the tributary running up in it. Didn't go past the no trespassing signs I know that are up on their actual property line. Their reporters hadn't even gotten over the true property line and still took them to jail. See, that was a hoax right there. Everything's a hoax. Everything's a fraud. You're not going to kangaroo indict me. You're going to have to work for it. So I went and jumped in the kayak, then sent it the wrong direction and swam off. It was actually pretty fun. They had the police just running around looking for me. Oh, my gosh, an evil reporter. And of course, they've arrested a lot of reporters that sneak in there. Vanity Fair, People Magazine, CBS. So I just think it's funny that, you know, I said I'd cover that a little while. I kind of just covered it, I guess. You know who snuck in and got footage? Nobody else did? And you know, it's not because I'm skilled. It's because I got God with me. You Star Wars nerds got the Force with you? Believe me, in my life, I got God with me. Doesn't mean I'm perfect. Doesn't mean I have all the answers. But InfoWars has been able to break every record, infiltrate every operation, blow the criminal cover of operatives more than any other institution out there of freedom. And I'm so proud of that. And every time I get upset because I can't beat these people fully, I just got to remember that we've had a lot of victories and praise God for it. So I've got to be more positive. I just beat myself up wanting to take these people down. I am sick of them. I am tired of them, and they are going to get it politically. They're stinking world governments out in the open. The fact that the Saudis ran 9/11 and the FBI was ordered to stand down is out in the open. Everything we told you is out in the open. Where are the apologies from Fox News, MSNBC, and CNN? Where are the apologies from Glenn Beck? Where are the apologies from Rush Limbaugh? Where are the apologies from Sean Hannity? Where are the apologies? They are nowhere. Because everybody wants to play it safe and go along with the system. You can't play it safe when your house is on fire. You can't negotiate with it. And instinctively, I cannot go along with this. I just can't give in. I can't give up, and I never will. Because giving in to them is dying in my spirit. I feel like claustrophobic or like I'm drowned or like I'm in the process of it when I even think about giving in, backing off. It's the only time I feel weak, only time I feel soulless, only time I feel dishonorable is to even entertain in my mind, not that I'm thinking about selling out or going along or backing off or not pushing as hard, but when my mind even entertains the idea, it's like an energy field that will suck my soul out. And I just, the God-fearing instincts I have make me just go, go harder. That's not enough. You've got to fight them. These people deal and kidnap kids. These people put fluoride in your water to brain damage you and your family and in the vaccines. These people are coming for everybody. I'm not going to wait around to be soft killed. I'm not going to wait around and watch my family die around me. I'm going to die fighting in the info war against these people. And I'll tell you something. They want to get a civil war going. They want to be at the local level to against the police and local bureaucrats who don't even know what's going on average. More informing the public, but not informed. Because they know it's coming. They can't believe our restraint this far. But let me tell you something. Nobody's putting any vaccines for me and my children. You want to assault me? I'll defend myself. And this is the point that we're now coming down to. And folks, you're going to have decisions put right in front of you as the tyranny gets worse and worse and worse and worse. And you're going to have to decide whether you're going to go with the political correctness, which is tyranny, and go with the end of freedom and go with totalitarianism and its control of language, or whether you're going to decide to start fighting. You start telling people about this radio show, do your own podcast, do your own local radio show, put up a billboard, call into talk radio, sue bureaucrats that violate your rights, run for office, get aggressive, put bumper stickers up everywhere, pray, There's don't eat GMO, grow some of your own food, wear Patriot t-shirts out, find like-minded people, and go out on the street corner. I don't care what it is. The act of doing something and resisting will grow into a mission for you. But you've got to make the decision to take the first steps, and then Providence, I guarantee you, if you fight tyranny for the right reasons, not to be famous, not to be cool, not to just have opposition to people, but if you do it really wanting to help folks and are praying to God to guide you, you'll just see suddenly cops dealing drugs, you'll videotape it, and they'll go to prison. You'll suddenly just catch the mayor snorting cocaine in the bathroom. You will just suddenly see a congressman doing something criminal. I mean, you just go to the town halls, go to the events. Just, I'm telling you, folks, you engage the enemy by just being there and just deciding, I want to do something against you. People always overplan and they wait and someday they're going to do this. Look, write a book, write an article, email your friends the articles we write. That's the easiest. Send them the link to Infowars.com/show to the free video and audio feeds. Share your PrisonPlanet.tv memberships. I mean, this is a good platform to promote, but it's more important for you to go down and speak at city council on whatever you wish to speak on. It's more important for you to go to the state house and talk to those legislatures. We'll be back. At Infowars.com, police deny brutal beating of white man by black mob was racially motivated. Report originally stated incident was anti-white attack. And if you watch the video, this is happening all over where whites, not blacks, are being attacked. So the next time the Klan, even though it's rare comparatively, wasn't rare back in the 50s and 60s, goes out and attacks a black person, we'll just say that's not racial either. But why won't they do this? Because it doesn't fit the narrative that only white people engage in racial activities. Notice now in the Democratic Party, everything is about what color you are or how you identify. The opposite of what Martin Luther King said. I mean, just recognize how evil the White House and MSNBC are. The Washington Post is out now saying people are against Jade Helm drills that start in about a week and run through August because we don't like a black president. No, we know the military is training for domestic takeover. We're not saying this is the takeover. We're saying we want details. Because they say they're going to simulate criminal activity. And they spin it and say the Americans are coming. Some in Texas county fear an Obama-led U.S. military invasion. Total misrepresentation of what we've been saying for 3 months. But now it's racist. And then, boom, if you say illegals are in a crime spree and above the law and keep getting released, you're racist, even though it's true. Illegal immigrant deported 6 times, charged in felony hit and run, a family that injured young children still in the hospital. Meanwhile, the San Francisco sheriff defends releasing killer, calls Trump an opportunist. That's the sheriff of San Francisco County that had released the 5-time deported, 7-time felon who had shot the young woman, Francisco Sanchez, just did it for no reason, according to witnesses, and then now he says he was shooting at sea lions, or it was in a bag, he didn't know it was a gun. I mean, believe whatever made-up story you want. We better just let him go, or we're racist. This is how to paralyze people. Now Trump says infectious diseases is pouring across the border. Well, that's true. It's why you got to take all the medications when you go down south. I mean, it's just crazy. It's like saying when Europeans came, they didn't bring smallpox. It's just a fact. But now he claims the gun went off accidentally, and that it was wrapped up. But now at Trump hotel site, immigrant workers are wary of him. Well, let's find out if the construction company he's using is employed illegals. Because, by the way, it is a crime in Mexico, big time, to work in Mexico without a worker permit. But that's okay. They're allowed to put illegal immigrants for 6 months to a year hard labor. It's okay. Mexico has the most draconian immigration laws in the Western Hemisphere because Mexico has some brown people in it. But if America has any laws, we're racist. Let's go ahead and go to the clip of the San Francisco County sheriff. Pretty sick.
Long before Francisco Sanchez opened fire and killed Kate Steinle on Pier 14, San Francisco's sanctuary city status has been a source of contention. Sheriff Mercurimi says the policy is clear. He needs a court order or a warrant. In Sanchez's case, ICE only asked for a detainer, which the sheriff says under city law isn't good enough.
Local governments have the right to require a legal instrument such as a court order
or a
warrant.
ICE has no city-by-city breakdown.
Touring like
statewide. In the last 18 months, more than 10,000 undocumented immigrants have been released from custody in California without immigration officials being notified. And the sheriff tried to turn the table on ICE, saying they are the ones that need to make sure they get it right.
If ICE does not provide the proper legal instrument, they are jeopardizing also the city's ability
to
detain somebody.
That's enough. Shut him up. That is sophistic baloney. They gave them the instrument. You were supposed to under federal and state law, but you have a city law that no one will sue to reverse in 800 plus cities that you release felons, rapists, killers who over and over again because they're an illegal immigrant. Oh, you'll turn a citizen over when they've been incarcerated for a state issue if there's a federal felony for something, but not if it's an illegal. And then meanwhile, the media runs with hoax stories that whites are killing blacks. They're just made up. And then police come out, the police chief, and denies brutal beating. We'll play some of the video now. Of white man by black mob was racially motivated, even though they're screaming expletives, attacking the police, because folks think this is how you demonstrate now. We're going to come back and play some of that. The video's on Infowars.com. I mean, look, he's obviously a white devil. He probably just should have been killed. And then give the people that did it a medal. I mean, this is crazy, folks, that the media... This is political correctness. I mean, this is how they want to cause civil war in this country. This is totally sick. We have been warned. We have been warned. We have been threatened. We have been told through official channels, unofficial channels, threats, you name it, stop investigating Sandy Hook. Now, when this first happened a few years ago, I didn't come out of the gate saying it was a false flag. And I got criticized by a lot of our listeners who were smart folks and who went and really investigated that, hey, Alex, you need to look at this again. All I know is that the official story doesn't add up, and that when retired state police officers and school investigation experts and school safety experts and others began to investigate it, they were threatened. No emergency helicopters were sent. The ambulances came an hour and a half later and parked down the road. DHS an hour and a half later with a timestamp put up signs saying sign in here. They had porta potties being delivered within an hour and a half. It looked like a carnival. Looked like a big PR stunt. Came out that Bloomberg, a day before, sent an email out to his gun control groups in all 50 states saying prepare to roll. We're a major operation coming up. That came out in the news. We have the emails from city council back and forth and the school talking about it being shut down a year before. We have the school then being demolished and the records being sealed. We have videos that look just incredibly suspicious where people are laughing and everything and they start huffing and puffing and start crying on TV, which is pure acting method. You've got a degree, Rob, in theater. I mean, this is something that even lay people notice. So I began to investigate. They had a weird anti-terrorism unit from the state nearby with men in the woods, which were on video from helicopter. Then they said that didn't exist. And so we'll recap some of the history of this. But now, your uncle, John Doe, Navy SEAL, retired FBI agent, works for a successful security company. I had missed this episode of the Nightly News back on June 4th. And then again last week when you did an update. And then I heard you talking about it yesterday. I knew that we'd sent our reporter, Dan Bedondi, there for days to cover the city council hearings about it and the fact that they're sealing everything. And then you just said, oh, yes, and that's why I'm trying to get my uncle to tell me more, because he's been in John Gotti hearings and been involved in huge cases, a pretty prominent FBI agent before he retired. And in his words, he said he's seen the most secretive mafia stuff ever, and he's never seen people more close-lipped. He's never seen something where it basically stinks. And we'll use his words, but the headline here is retired FBI agent investigating Sandy Hook. I mean, that was just amazing to me that so much goes on around here that I miss some of what's happening. Next time a former Navy SEAL FBI agent, I don't care if it's your uncle, is investigating something like this, we want to hear about it. I want to try to get him on. I know he's going to get heat probably, and they'll probably try to threaten him, but really kudos to him. I mean, you told me that he went and investigated it because other insiders said, you need to go look at this. I guess people currently in the FBI aren't allowed to. But man, the fix is in. So Rob Due, tell us about your uncle. Tell us about all this. I wish we'd gotten more than a 2-minute interview with him, with Badandi. Badandi did a great job. I just wish I'd have known about this. I would have gone up there. Halbig tried to get me to go. I just am trying to launch the TV network and the new website and everything else. But I mean, this is just so big. And the more we look at Sandy Hook, I don't want to believe it's a false flag. I don't know if kids really got killed, but you got green screen with Anderson Cooper, where I was watching the video and the flowers and plants are blowing in some of them, and then they blow again the same way. It's looped, and then his nose disappears. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's fake. The whole thing is just, I don't know what happened. It's kind of like you see a hologram at Disney World in the haunted house. You know, I don't know how they do it, but it's not real. When you take your kids to see the haunted house and ghosts are flying around, they're not real, folks. It's staged. I mean, the magician grabs a rabbit out of his hat. I know he's got a box under the table that he reaches in and gets the rabbit. I don't know what the trick is here. I got a good suspicion. But when you've got Wolfgang Halbig, who was the top, I mean, 2020, CNN, I mean, ran the most successful school safety course in the country, got the contracts at Columbine, making millions of dollars a year. He believed it was real. People called him. He went and investigated. No paperwork, no nothing. It's bull. And now an FBI retired agent who retired, you know, with decorations. I mean, this is just unprecedented. I can't believe I missed this. Recap what happened. We've got some of the questions from Badandi, but he told you a lot more. Well, just tell us what he said.
Sure. Well, I first got a text from Badandi, and it was this picture that they just showed, and it's Dan standing with my uncle.
Let's show that document. And, shot your phone.
They just shot it. So it's right there, and I'm like, why is Dan Badandi standing with my uncle?
You didn't even know this.
No contact.
He was there.
I had no idea he was there. And I texted Dan. I said, why are you with my uncle? He goes, oh, he was at the hearing.
It's your dad's brother.
I was like, what? So I called up my uncle, and I ended up talking to him. I called him that night that I got the text, and he's like, hey, let's talk tomorrow. So I called him the next day. I was actually at the dry cleaner picking up stuff to go to Bilderberg. And I'm talking to him. Talked to him for about 15 minutes in the parking lot. And he goes, I go, why? Who told you about this? Why'd you go up there?
He goes, well, did he say this was off record? I don't want to get him in trouble.
Everything that I talked about, he said, we could talk.
Okay.
And so I said, well, what made you want to go up there to the hearings? This is the second hearing. And he said, well, a friend of mine told me that I should go up there and look at it. There's some suspicious stuff going on. And so this is after the first hearing came out, where there was all kind of, you could watch the lawyer, Monty Frank is his name, who also has a vested interest in keeping the Sandy Hook narrative alive, because he runs a Team 26. He's a cycling guy, and he runs this big donation firm where they run around on bikes. And
it's all Bloomberg anti-gunners.
Right. Oh, yeah. He's a big anti-gunner.
This is about making them all, you know, basically torchbearers for the,
exactly,
the victims, the martyrs.
Right. And so he is the main attorney that you'll see in the videos when we go to those. He's the ball-headed guy. And he even told some people who were subpoenaed not to show up. Four people didn't show up to the first hearing because he told them not to show up.
And Halbig is subpoenaing them.
Yeah, Halbig was subpoenaing. And it costs like $300 for each one of these subpoenas.
And why would Halbig stop making his millions of dollars a year, make his wife mad at him, and do all this? And he had government come to his house twice and threaten him to stop.
Yeah. You know, he's only interested in the truth. He actually gave money. He even admitted that he gave money to the Sandy Hook Fund in the beginning when it first happened, because he felt so bad about it. But he keeps finding all these questions, and it's little things, but it's following paper trails. All these bureaucracies have paper trails. And it just doesn't add up. And that's what my uncle said.
So, yeah, tell us everything he said.
So I said, what did you think? He said, well, I've never sat in a court proceeding like this ever in my life. I said, what do you mean? He goes, here's, you got this small town, the biggest event in their history by far, and nobody knows nothing. Nobody remembers anything, and there's no paperwork for anything.
No paperwork.
I just don't understand how this is going on in this small town. And I go, well, what do you mean? He goes, even when we were, you know, going after the mob, he goes,
he said Gotti.
They would remember. Well, Gotti, he didn't say Gotti, but I remember back in the day, my dad talked, he was, you know, working on.
So it was Gotti.
Yeah. Well, one of the guys, there was a lot of different mobsters they were going after back in the 80s and 90s. I guess he retired sometime in the 90s. But he said, you know, we never had a case where nobody knew nothing. You know, he said, I just couldn't understand it. How in this small town, nobody knows anything. The school board guy doesn't know anything. The maintenance guy doesn't know anything. The head select woman doesn't know anything. Stuff is being delivered and nobody knows how it got there.
So this town's mascot is Sergeant Schultz.
Essentially, yeah. And there you got that checkout sign he thought was a big deal. He's like, wow, what was DHS doing there? So that's the big question.
How were they there an hour and a half after the shooting? Helicopter, and there's a check-in sign with porta-potties being delivered.
Right. There's the check-in sign right there. There's a shot of that. You can see it. It'll pop up there. Everyone must check in. And so they asked the select woman who they say runs the town, essentially. Her name's Pat Ladroa. And they ask her, did you pay for this sign? She goes, nobody paid for this sign. Nothing came out of.
No one knows who delivered the signs to direct everyone.
Well, they ask her.
The porta potties.
And she goes.
But
she
said, rescue helicopters and the ambulances
exactly,
are held down.
Exactly. But we got electronic signs for everybody to check in.
And clipboards.
She goes, I believe it was Homeland Security. So she believes Homeland Security delivered that sign.
Good God.
So they were already on the scene right after it happened.
They ran fast and furious, killing thousands of Mexicans, hundreds of Americans, including six law enforcement, to blame the Second Amendment. CBS News got the memo. Yeah. That was a false flag, killing thousands to blame the Second Amendment and martyr Mexicans and say you're racist if you don't turn your guns in. So they've done it before, and my gosh, they've done it again. Yeah. Keep going.
Well, guys, actually, let's play the clip from my uncle. It's actually clip number two. We'll play that one first. It's really short. Dan,
I want to play it, but tell us more of what he said, because you told me more than that.
Okay. Well, He was concerned that there, because he had believed in the initial story, the official story. And he said, well, now this doesn't add up. If you have all these people, they should just be giving the paperwork and going on with their lives. If they don't want, you know, because right now it's all being.
It's 101. They're covering it up.
He goes, nobody acts like that if they're on.
It's like if a cop pulls you over and you're busy cramming stuff under the seat.
Right. Saying, don't worry. Hold on. I'm looking for my license or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, nobody has the proper paperwork. Nobody can deliver it. They deliver videos without timestamps from police squad cars. There's videos without timestamps that they give to them and say, these are the copies from the squad car. Yet you go online and you can see squad car video from the same squad car and it's got time code on it. So how did they give him video without time code? And he's viewing it at the police station.
This is mega massive cover up.
It's crazy. So, he just basically, my uncle doesn't say much. He's the kind of guy that doesn't say a lot. So Dan, I don't know how Dan figured out he was my uncle. But he went over and talked to him.
Oh, your uncle's not telling you he's up there.
No. He never told me he was going up there. I got the text from Dan. That's how I found out he was there. And then I texted him, and then I called him the next day because he couldn't talk at the time. It was like probably 11:30 at night that night. It was June
3rd. Well, I suggest you call him and see what he thinks now, see if he's been threatened or anything. But please continue with what else he told you. So, former Navy SEAL, retired FBI agent, Sandy Hook doesn't add up.
Pretty much. He
said, quote, that's the quote, doesn't add up.
Well, we could take the quote from him. He said he's never seen anything like this before.
But to you, what did he say?
What he's saying is that from all of his experience in the years that he has worked as an FBI agent, he's retired. He went into the FBI pretty much out of the Navy. He was he went to the Naval Academy. He was a Navy SEAL. This guy is on the up and up. I've known him all my life. You know, he doesn't tell you what he does in terms of, you know, when we used to go up there and visit him when he was working, and he would just leave and come back, and you know, he was doing casework or whatever. But from what he told me, he said that this thing doesn't add up, and it's the weirdest court proceeding he's ever been in his entire life. And he's been in a lot of court proceedings.
Let me tell you, we get more threats over this than anything. I mean, they're hiding something.
They definitely are.
Let's ask your opinion, your gut level, without getting into the personalities involved. You can clearly see they're scared. The wagons are circled. They could just release all this. There is no paperwork.
No, there is no.
I mean, that's what they've. It's all. So I mean, it, I guess totally made up with green screens, everything, and we've got them on green screens. What is going on here?
That's how evil
these people are. Is that they can have CNN involved? All these people. It's like a Manhattan Project of the gun grabbers.
Alex, you have kids. If your kids go on a field trip or anything, my kids, if they go on a field trip to the park next door, we have to sign a permission slip. Okay? There's no permission slips, no nothing for the Sandy Hook choir to go down to the Super Bowl. So that was one of the things Wolfgang was asking for through the school board. He's like, where is this approved? There's no mention of it anywhere. Like, hey, we're glad our kids went to the Super Bowl. Let's give them a hand. Let's give them some recognition. And he was at a school board meeting at Sandy Hook, and they were talking about all this other event that happened, and they're making a big deal out of it. Why would they not make any deal out of kids going to sing at the Super Bowl? They're being identified on CBS News.
But what about how, for a mass shooting in Pakistan, they got photos of Sandy Hook kids?
They got photos of one of the kids. Yeah. It's weirder and weirder and weirder. Yeah, you can see that. They're holding pictures of him, and it's not just one time. He's on another billboard. Yeah, as you scroll down, you could see.
It's like the same PR company there is running again. This.
It's not like.
And then they try to hit us with fake copyright deals whenever we show this.
Yeah, exactly. And it's not There it is. It's on three different locations.
All right. Radio listeners don't know what we're talking about.
You gotta show folks
the article, and I'll give the radio listeners the headlines they can see it for themselves. Mystery. Sandy Hook victim dies again in Pakistan. Photo of child killed at Sandy Hook shows up in Pakistan school shooting at multiple rallies.
Yeah.
I mean, ladies and gentlemen, we are on to something big here. Let's go ahead and go to part of this clip with your uncle. This is John Dew, our news director's uncle, that we just suddenly see at the Sandy Hook hearing with our reporter. Here's Dan Bedondi.
And what do you think? You witnessed the whole hearing here. Was you here last time, too?
No.
No, but being here today, what did you think of the whole thing?
Very strange. Yeah.
Very strange?
Very strange situation, yes.
Yeah, no, so what do you expect to come out of this? You think they're going to try to cover this up, or is this going to go anywhere?
I really don't know. I've never seen anything like this before.
And again, I'm glad Bedondi was there. Great job, and I wish it would have gone on more.
Yeah. I tell you, my uncle doesn't talk that much. And
look at the look on his face.
You know, yeah, he's like, You know, and when I was talking to him, he wasn't saying a lot, but he's like, you know, Robert, this is strange. I've never seen anything like it. Never seen anything like it. And he's been in court cases. It's not like his first.
But you said he also said it doesn't add up.
Oh, yeah. Nothing adds up. It adds up.
What was his exact quote? Because I want to put it in an article.
I would say take that from there. Let me explain something.
You're a reporter.
Right.
You're a news director. This is your uncle. It's incredible for you to quote somebody. Go back to the memory. What did he say?
I'll think about the exact words, but from what I remember, because I was in the car driving while I was talking to him. I had an earpiece in.
I understand.
Talking to him. Because I wanted to get something out of him before we did, because we did the show that night on the 4th, that day on the 4th. And I wanted to talk about it. I said, hey, I've got this short interview with you, you know, and you're saying it's strange. It doesn't add up. He's like, I've never been in a court proceeding like that ever where people don't know anything.
And here's the news. He's up there and not telling the family.
Yeah.
That's it. And then somehow, I don't know. I guess Bedondi probably asked him his name. And he said, Dew. And he goes, I know a guy named Dew. Well, you got to call Bedondi and get him on the news to find out how he knew.
Yeah.
And I want to make a big deal out of this. It's a big deal.
Well, and tomorrow there's actually the final, I guess, the closing arguments. They had two hearings now. Now they're going to have the closing arguments tomorrow.
Well, will you please call your uncle before they try to get to him?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I actually texted him, told him about the third hearing that's going to go on. I said, hey, you need to check this out. He hasn't gotten back with me on that.
So where does he live up there?
Yeah. He lives up, but he doesn't live in Connecticut. He lives south of New York City.
Oh, so New Jersey.
Yeah.
Anyways, come on. It's not a secret agent thing. You can tell. The people that did Sandy Hook knows where your uncle lives.
I'm sure they do. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like Larry Nichols gives his home address out. It's like, by the way, Larry Nichols is on Thursday. All right, dude, good job covering all this. We only skim the surface. I mean, I don't want to be the one reporting all this. It's super dangerous, but it's just the truth. From the Post television, the newspaper, the Post, Jade Helm isn't a military takeover of Texas. No, we've already been taken over by the globalists that run the federal government. We're already having our power plant shut down, and they're already declaring patriots to the enemy, and that the borders are wide open. And I mean, we're already under a dictatorial system. And yes, the Army Times reports the military is training to take on Americans. We're not saying the Army is the enemy or the Marines are the enemy. We're saying we know Posse Comitatus has been trod underfoot, and these military drills are about conditioning the public. I'm going to get more into that in a moment. Just briefly, they came in and told me, first we had the idea to pre-sell the new product, Brain Force, that has a couple things in it that are prescription in Europe, that are totally natural, that are known to boost the brain's capacity, not in a speedy way, but in a healthy way. We ordered a limited amount as a test. Everybody loved it. Sold out in 3 days. And so it's not in. You can go sign up at InfoWarsLife.com, and we'll send you an email when it does come in. But they then doubled back and said, you know, it might be more than 4 weeks. We better not let people pre-order. So we're not going to do that. That said, if you want your survival shield, Nascent Iodine X2, that is the good halogen that has been so amazing in my body and my family's bodies. It's known to detoxify, known to block the bad halogens. It's just amazing. This is going to sell out very, very soon. And super male and super female vitality are. And your purchase also makes the broadcast possible. And the reason I keep raising this sold out issue is Brain Force is sold out, Liver Shield is sold out, Prostaguard is sold out, Child Ease is sold out, Occupower is sold out. People say, well, why don't you just order more? It's so hard to source these because of the ingredients, because our products are so good. We could put crap out and have plenty of it. But, I mean, these are the highest quality. Occupower sold out. Survival Shield X2, we still have it, about to be sold out. Super Male Vitality, selling out. Super Female Vitality, selling out. Then we've got Oxy Powder, selling out. Secret 12, in stock. We ordered a ton of that. Silver Bullet, Colloidal Silver, in stock. Oil Oregano, just came back in stock. Winter Sun, in stock. DNA Force, in stock. Lung Cleanse, in stock. And it's your purchase of those that helps fund the operation. But whether it's a Life Straw or whether it's a Patriot T-shirt or a Molon Labe belt buckle, free shipping in the month of July. Free shipping in the month of July, on top of all the other discounts, like 25% off Molon Labe belt buckles, 10% off all T-shirts, InfoWarsStore.com. If you have any questions or like to order over the phone, 888-253-3139. That's 888-253-3139. And then, of course, PrisonPlanet.tv memberships. One membership's $5.95 a month. 20 people can use each membership. It is your support of this transmission that makes it all possible. See all my films. See the nightly news live as it happens. See it all. PrisonPlanet.tv. And they've got a big nightly news coming up tonight, 7 o'clock Central at PrisonPlanet.tv. Jade Helm is kicking off. We're going to be launching tonight an email on air. JadeHelm@InfoWars.com. That all our reporters are going to be checking, that I'm going to be checking. And when you see military activity, you need to call us, but more importantly, you need to videotape it. This is your country. You've done nothing wrong. March right up and videotape the military. A lot of them will be in plain clothes, but they stick out like sore thumbs. They'll be walking around with portable radios. They'll be doing all sorts of stuff. And they could easily use this, not by our military, but by a terror group working for the globalists to piggyback on a drill that simulates what the attack that actually happens. So if the terrorists get caught, they won't be Islamic. They can then claim they're part of the drill. So these drills are used as cover. They're really upset that we're covering it for some reason. We need to be on target, not just here, but nationwide during any military activity. GCN. Stay vigilant. One is by land, two is by sea, three is by Obama tyranny. All right, in overdrive here, here's the Washington Post from July 4th on Independence Day. The Americans are coming. Some in Texas County fear an Obama-led U.S. military invasion. So again, the PSYOP is when there isn't a takeover, when there isn't martial law, oh, we're discredited in thousands of news articles. They've already written thousands claiming we're saying this. Now, for a month or so, they didn't have that many articles. It was hundreds a day for weeks. Now they're back, and they interview a black Bastrop city council person, Doc Jackson. We got to go interview him, and he says that that this is a red flag that our country still has a lot of things that need to come to terms with, including the anger and disrespect being directed at the president. And they go on to say it's racist hate to not just love the military everywhere running around the streets. I mean, I was exposing militarization of police and drills when Bush was in. And no one we talked to in Bastrop said it was about black people. You don't like Obamacare, you're racist. Don't want to turn your guns in, you're racist. They inject this into everything to say you're basically a heretic if you don't go along with it. And the article basically says that it's racist and we believe an imminent invasion's happening. This is why mainstream media is in so much trouble, and it's why people don't believe you. Because everyone reading this that participated knows you're a liar, and everybody else that watches media and reads it knows not to believe you. That's why in national polls people don't trust Jade Helm. They go too far because they don't believe anything you do anymore. And that's healthy, because the Pentagon admits they want to be ready to take out civil unrest in America, and they're gearing up for it. And people know we're in a recession / depression. They know unemployment's higher than you say. They know you're a pack of liars. Now let's go to the Washington Post TV piece that's separate from this article. Here it is.
The U.S. military will soon launch a mission in which it operates among the U.S. public and travels from state to state in military aircraft. In the exercise, Texas, Utah, and a part of Southern California are labeled as enemy territory. New Mexico isn't considered much friendlier. That's the scheme for Jade Helm 15, a new special operation exercise that begins in July. The Army says the size and scope of the mission set it apart from many other training exercises.
Mm-hmm.
Also setting it apart, the widespread conspiracy theories that the United States is preparing to hatch martial law. That is especially so in Texas, which was labeled as hostile in military briefing slides prepared for local officials. Texas Governor Greg Abbott even recently called for the Texas State Guard to monitor the mission. The military has tried to tamp down speculation about Jade Helm, but the conspiracy theories have persisted because of a handful of websites that say not to trust the military or the media and rampant speculation online.
This is part of the psyop. Look at what they say unconventional warfare is. It's going in and using deceit to try to control the people.
This Jade Helm 15 logo. This has a satanic hidden meaning.
Helm means homeland eradication of local militants.
Oh, no, you don't. Oh, no, you don't. Here we go again, folks.
What do we begin to see here behind the Walmart in Texas? Humvees.
This is in preparation for the financial collapse and maybe even Obama not leaving office.
Now, here's what we know is true. The military routinely launches exercises in which regions of the United States are labeled as hostile for the purpose of training.
Only in the last few years.
They date back decades at the very least. Among them is Bold Alligator, a naval exercise involving thousands of Marines and sailors.
As Congressman Gohmert said, and he was in the military and he's on the committee, they've never done this. This is new. It's very suspicious. We're not saying it's imminent. They mix a bunch of folks speculating. And the telltale sign is you're hearing 3-second clips from us. Mixed in with other people, so you think it's us saying it. I mean, just another psyop. Psyops don't work when people don't buy them anymore, punk. Let's go back to Punk's video.
The most recent version was launched in the fall and included amphibious landings to fight insurgent groups in the fictional country of Garnet, Georgia, and part of Florida in real life. Then there's Robin Sage. U.S. Special Forces support fictional guerrillas in counties across North Carolina.
Totally
Green
different.
Beret soldiers work to liberate the country of Pineland
and
operate
50
around
years.
Civilians. 6 months from now, Jade Helm will likely fade from discussion.
All right, that's it.
For now, though.
So that's their plan. And when none of this bad stuff happens, they'll say we're discredited. It's a straw man. They're full.